millions of viewers since 1980 when you went with the Today Show. What do you enjoy most about this job and least?
Oh, well, the best thing is traveling, the country. I got to have a little asterisk by the word traveling, because as I get older, I must say the physical act of getting from A to B is really, kind of rough anymore. But once I get there, I go crazy. I just came back from Kansas City. I flew in on Sunday night, ate ribs till they came out my ear. I like seeing the people and doing the remote. I really enjoy that. And then I left Monday morning after the show and came back to the studios in Washington. But I like that very, very much. That is my favorite part of the show. I don't have any really negative parts of the show. In other words, I don't even mind getting up early. A lot of people say, oh, I have to get up early in the morning. I'm so used to it now that even Saturday and Sundays, I wake up. I get up at 3:30. And I don't get up Saturday and Sunday at 3:30, but I wake up and then I roll over and go back to bed, but I'll stay, I get up 5:30. I don't sleep all day.
Can you run through a typical day?
I get up now about 3:15, 3:30, because I live 60 miles out of town on a farm and I have to commute. And a friend of mine picks me up and brings me in about 5. So I take an hour to get organized, an hour and 15 minutes to get sort of squared away. Then it takes an hour and 20 minutes to get to town. And as you know, in this business, everything is pretty much done for you. Especially at the level of the Today Show, we have a weather office in New York, wonderful group, and they put all of the weather together. So all I have to come in and coordinate with Lysandra here in Washington, the plugs that we're going to do, the little announcements for the community projects, and of course the birthdays, which has turned out to be the greatest single thing that ever happened in my career. Then after that, it's like the iceberg, tip of the iceberg. The show is everything.
Your love of people, especially senior citizens. Where does that come from?
Yeah, it's amazing because, it came from my grandmother and my grandparents, both sides. I knew my grandparents on both sides, mother's side and father's side. And they both lived to be about 80 years old. And they both were farm people. And both sets. And I've always loved older people. And I have a mission about that. I can't say that setting up the birthdays on television was some divine guidance. The result of divine guidance. It was just somebody wrote me a letter one time, and I like ideas that that appeal to me. And somebody said, "Would you mention my cousin or my uncle's birthday? He's going to be 100 years old." I did, never thinking what would happen. And then it's the biggest. We're the largest clearinghouse for centenarians in the country right now. We get more mail about it than even the White House, wishing people 100 happy 100th birthdays. But even before that, and that was pure dumb luck the way that's worked out. And it's been the greatest thing in my career without a question, the most significant. But the fact that I had the love and affection and the knowledge and guidance and all the good stuff of my grandparents, I treasure that. And I think that's one of the things wrong in America today. I think so many families are so split up and divided now that they are deprived of having that continuity of affection, I call it, between grandparents and parents and children and so forth. And I think we'd all be better served if we could have that, because it sure has done me a lot of good.
You know, I've had a lot of viewers ask me, is he for real?
Yeah.
You're very for real.
I'm actually one of the Perry Como had a record out one time. Is he really a press agent's dream, or what was it? Or is it all just a pitch? Is Perry really nice, or just one big son of a guy? La la la. I basically, we were talking this morning. That's why I think it's worked so well for me, because I love what I do. I'm not a product of a public relation movement or a PR guy, and I just enjoy it. Unfortunately, in a case like that, when things start to fall apart, I don't have a whole lot to fall back on, as far as like a lot of people have different little avenues to promote themselves. And if it can't be fun and real, it's time to get out.
Can you tell our viewers a little bit about your roots?
Well, fortunately, as I say, I was born and raised right in this area. That's why I love Washington so much. I was born over in Alexandria, Virginia, and my grandparents had their farm, and I'd spend all summers with them and a lot of weekends, one in Maryland, one in North Carolina. But I went to school here, raised here with the old First Baptist Church in Alexandria, went to grade school and high school, and then went to American University, which is right across the street from this building in Washington. So, and my wife's a Washington girl. She's a native Washingtonian. So we really are kind of a rare breed for around here.
Willard, who were your mentors?
The number one guy in my career in the broadcasting business was Arthur Godfrey. I idolized him. And there again, Arthur Godfrey, I hate to say there's a generation here that probably doesn't even remember him, but Arthur Godfrey at one time had the top 3 radio shows and probably the top 2 TV shows in the history of the business. It just ran like Paul Harvey is on radio today. Arthur Godfrey was first, second, third, fourth. There was nobody else on the track. And he started, he actually started at this station, WRC. Actually started WFBR in Baltimore. And the old redhead, some of your viewers do know and some don't. But he single-handedly probably made more money in a day when a dollar was a dollar for CBS. He was an incredible moneymaker. He was an incredible audience getter. He had a warm style that wasn't always his real persona, I'm told. I met him twice in my career. He was very pleasant to me, but I idolized him because he had a one-on-one. I think the two things that I have tried to adapt, one is his style, because he had that wonderful intimacy with a microphone first and then with a camera. And I tried to emulate him because, as I say, he worked out of Washington for years on the local station. The other thing was, incidentally, NBC fired him because he was late for work. So they, a la Letterman, that was the early day Letterman. I mean, they got rid of him, said, you're not dependable, you can't make it. And anyway, I threw that in as a little, couldn't resist it. But the fact is that doing the children's shows, doing Bozo, gives you an intimacy with the camera. You've got that wonderful ability to be able to talk to the camera as an individual and as a friend. Because so many people that are reading teleprompters, I don't care how close you're reading the teleprompter, you're always staring at their navel. And there's no, you know, there's no real great eye contact. It's always a little fake. But those two, working as a disciple of Godfrey and doing children's shows, were the two things that shaped my career the most. Bozo. How can you be Bozo in Washington, D.C.? The competition is too much. They ran me out of business. Congress and a couple of politicians. Now, Bozo was right here at this station, this very building that we're in right now is where Bozo was born. Wes Harris, who later became NBC program director, I guess, one of the titles. But Wes was our local program director. And 1959, because it was the same year I got married, it was really one of the great moments in my life, not getting married, but being Bozo, because I really almost was aced out of a honeymoon because of Bozo. We were going to go on our honeymoon, and I had to be back on, we left Friday, I had to come back Sunday because I went to Los Angeles to go to clown school with Larry Harmon, who created Bozo. And I've often said I was the only guy on the staff young enough to play Bozo. All the other guys were older, the staff announcers. So they assigned me to be Bozo the Clown right here in Washington. I was about the third or fourth Bozo in the country. You know, each city had its own Bozo. And I think the one in Chicago is still going strong. I mean, they've lined up for a year to get tickets. But it was a wonderful show. And then the great thing that happened to me as a result of Bozo was that I worked for the local McDonald's chain here, GG Distributors, they were called. And I would play Bozo for them. Every time they'd open a McDonald's, they'd hire me to be a clown. And then Bozo went off the air after 3 years locally. And they needed somebody to work for McDonald's. So they came to me and they said, we like you as a clown. Would you like to be a clown for McDonald's? And I said, sure. So they said, well, get a costume. And so I came up with the name Donald McDonald, because that's, you know, people remember that. Mrs. Hubbard down at Jack Mulane's Costumers, 11th and G, she made the costume. Janet Vaughn, the old Cal agency, designed it. And I wish we had a picture. Maybe you can throw one in here somewhere if you can find a copy of it. It was pretty commercial. I mean, it had a hamburger hat and a hamburger belt that dispersed hamburgers. But then, of course, Ronald McDonald became a legend. I mean, Ronald McDonald is probably, next to Santa Claus, the biggest character in this country.
Being nice, like on an airplane or something, when people are constantly approaching you?
I could give you the institutional answer and say no, it's always, but no, you get tired a little bit. I get tired, that's the whole point, and you want to sleep or something. I've had one day, this is a funny story, I think, because I fake sleeping a lot. In other words, if you really want to be by yourself, you can either do one of two things, fake a sleep or go in the John. And I've done both. You know, you just sit there and lock yourself in the John at the airport for an hour, smoke your cigar, you know, and sit there and read the paper and relax. And but one time I really was asleep. I sleep on a plane beautifully. I mean, I can sleep. They say weathermen sleep well because they lie easily. So I was asleep and I was sitting on the aisle. I mean, I was asleep, lip hanging down, drool coming out of my mouth. And while I was sleeping, this arm shakes me. And I came up with my fist raised. It was a priest. And he wanted me to plug some music program at his parish.
Do you have any special message for our viewers, Southern Oregon, Northern California?
Oh, I've always gotten a big kick out of coming out there. It's a little far for me to travel. But the Northwest is a very special place in my heart because Sally went to school up in Eugene. We used to, go to the Valley Inn and loved all the good food. And it's pretty tough to beat. I got the biggest kick out of when the sun would come out, people came out of the, like moles out of the ground. I've never seen people appear. It comes for 3 or 4 hours a day, it'll come out, and everybody's out there with their things under their neck trying to get the rays to give them some suntan.
Now, further south, we have lots of sun.
Oh, yeah,
I want you to come
visit. Closer to California, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, the other thing is blackberries. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. They grow out of the sidewalk up there, biggest blackberries in the world. But no, you come visit with me, and I'll come visit with you. I've already done that. I spent not a lot of time anymore, but I did when Sally was up there.
We love you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's very sweet of you to say that. Thanks for the interview.